If you were a praying mantis, it would be socially acceptable to devour your mate.
And if you're a honey badger, you have no regard for other animals. You don't care.
If you're a panda with twins, it's normal to abandon one to take care of the other.
But if humans do any of these things, we would call it wrong, unfair, or unjust.
Yeah, why is that? Why do humans care so much about justice?
Well, the Bible has a fascinating response to that question. On page one, humans are set apart from all other creatures as the image of God.
Yeah, God's representatives who rule the world by his definition of good and evil.
And this identity, it's the bedrock of the Bible's view of justice. All humans are equal before God and have the right to be treated with dignity and fairness no matter who you are.
And that would be nice if we all did that, but we know how the world really works.
And the Bible addresses that too. It shows how we are constantly redefining good and evil to our own advantage at the expense of others.
Yeah, self-preservation. And the weaker someone is, the easier it is to take advantage of them.
And so in the biblical story, we see this happening on a personal level, but also in families, and then in communities, and in whole civilizations that create injustice, especially towards the vulnerable. But the story doesn't end there. Out of this whole mess, God chose a man named Abraham to start a new kind of family. Specifically, Abraham was to teach his family to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice.
Yeah, doing righteousness, that's a Bible word I don't really use, but what comes to mind is being a good person.
But what does that even mean, being good? The biblical Hebrew word for righteousness is tzedakah, and it's more specific. It's an ethical standard that refers to right relationships between people. It's about treating others as the image of God.
With the God-given dignity they deserve.
And this word justice, it's the Hebrew word mishpat. It can refer to retributive justice.
Like if I steal something, I pay the consequences.
Exactly. Yet most often in the Bible, mishpat refers to restorative justice. It means going a step further, actually seeking out vulnerable people who are being taken advantage of and helping them.
Yeah, some people call this charity.
But mishpat involves way more. It means taking steps to advocate for the vulnerable and changing social structures to prevent injustice.
So justice and righteousness are about a radical, selfless way of life.
Yeah, and you find this idea all over the Bible. Like, here, in the book of Proverbs, what does it mean to bring about just righteousness?
Open your mouth for those who can't speak for themselves.
And what do these words mean for the prophets, like Jeremiah?
Rescue the disadvantaged, and don't tolerate oppression or violence against the immigrant, the orphan, and the widow.
And like here, look in the book of Psalms.
The Lord God upholds justice for the oppressed, gives food to the hungry, and sets the prisoner free. But he thwarts the way of the wicked. Whoa, he thwarts the wicked?
Yeah, in Hebrew, the word wicked is rasha. It means guilty or in the wrong. It refers to someone who mistreats another human, ignoring their dignity as an image of God.
So justice and righteousness is a big deal to God.
Yes, it's what Abraham's family, the Israelites, were to be all about. They ended up as immigrant slaves, being oppressed unjustly in Egypt. And so God confronted Egypt's evil, declaring them to be rasha, guilty of injustice. And so he rescued Israel. But the tragic irony of the Old Testament story is that these redeemed people went on to commit the same acts of injustice against the vulnerable. And so God sent prophets who declared Israel guilty.
But they weren't the only ones. There's injustice everywhere.
Yeah, some people actively perpetrate injustice. Others receive benefits or privileges from unjust social structures they take for granted. And sadly, history has shown that when the oppressed gain power, they often become oppressors themselves.
So we all participate in injustice, actively or passively, even unintentionally. We're all the guilty ones.
And so this is the surprising message of the biblical story. God's response to humanity's legacy of injustice is to give us a gift, the life of Jesus. He did righteousness and justice, and yet he died on behalf of the guilty. But then God declared Jesus to be the righteous one when he rose from the dead. And so now Jesus offers his life to the guilty so that they too can be declared righteous before God, not because of anything they've done, but because of what Jesus did for them.
The earliest followers of Jesus experienced this righteousness from God, not just as a new status, but as a power that changed their lives and compelled them to act in surprising new ways.
Yeah, if God declared someone righteous when they didn't deserve it, the only reasonable response is to go and seek righteousness and justice for others.
This is a radical way of life, and it's not always convenient or easy. It's courageously making other people's problems my problems.
This is what Jesus meant by loving your neighbor as yourself. It's about a lifetime commitment fueled by the words of the ancient prophet Micah. God has told you, humans, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. Is to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
Hey, this is John and Tim from the Bible Project. Thanks for watching this video. This was a theme video where we take one biblical motif and trace it from beginning to end. We also do a lot of other videos you can find here on our YouTube channel.
The Bible Project is a nonprofit animation studio, and we're crowdfunded, which means you can help us make the next videos. You can find more information at our website, thebibleproject.com.
We've got an old school Tayfun, and we've got a pretty old school work mobile. My children have got to use the old school phone to phone the mobile. And we'll see how long it takes.
Yeah.
Ready, steady, go.
Ah.
Probably do the other.
You reckon? How do you do one number?
I know. You have to do this.
Yes, you do.
Is that the only
you picked two? Up. That's a good start. What next? You're actually holding it the wrong way around.
Hi guys, tough one today. You've probably seen some of the scenes across America and actually across the world now, following the atrocious killing of George Floyd last week. And I just want to say to you, be affected by injustice and wrong in the world. Even if it doesn't directly affect you personally, let it affect you and find a way to respond. You know, protest, demonstrate, use your voice, stand up for what you believe in and against the things that are wrong. But do it peacefully and do it with others. That has more impact. We've done a couple of videos during this lockdown series. We've talked about apathy, which is a lack of interest, and indifference, which is a lack of concern. And we've talked about using your voice and speaking out against injustice. And we've talked about empathy, putting yourself in someone else's shoes. You know, it's hard to know what to do sometimes. I've certainly been guilty of not responding because I haven't known what to do. But the worst thing we can do is nothing. So I just want to encourage you at this time just to be thinking about how you can respond, not just to this situation, but when you see wrong in the world, whether it affects you or not, what are you going to do about it? Thank you.
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace.
Where there is hatred,
let me sow love.
Where there is injury,
pardon.
Where there is doubt,
faith.
Where there is despair,
hope.
Where there is darkness,
light.
Where there is sadness,
joy.
O divine Master,
grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled
as to console,
to be understood
as to understand,
not so much to be loved
as to love with all my soul.
For it is in giving
that we receive.
It is in pardoning
that we are pardoned.
It is in dying
that we are raised to eternal life.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome. It's really, really good to be with you this morning. Thanks for allowing us into your home. And we've begun this morning with a whole series of videos, which if you missed, you can go and catch up by watching the replay, or actually all of them are on the church website as well. And the last one that you've just seen was 28 churches from across Bath just gathering to say a simple prayer of blessing over the city together, to bless the city together. Couple of things as we get going. The first is if you are on Facebook, but also you can do this on YouTube, but it doesn't quite work as smoothly on YouTube. Please do use the chat features and say hi to folks. I can see a bunch of you have jumped on there already. Morning, Wendy, Vivian, Ali and Ernie, Pete, Ken, you're all here. Morning, really, really good to see you. And folks that are joining us from further afield, say hi to one another. And also the other thing is on the church website, I've put a few resources about justice issues in response to the news events that we've seen over the last couple of weeks. So please do go and check out those. And if you've got a suggestion as to how we could add to them, please do let us know. And we're going to begin our time together before we worship just by pressing into this a little bit. Meg.
So it's been a, as Clive already said in our pre-service film, it's been a really, really hard week. And there's been moments where it's been almost overwhelming in knowing how on earth we respond to all the things that are going on. And it's easy to say the things that are going on over in the States, but actually all of the stuff that's happened with the death of George Floyd and the protests that are going on there are really just opening a big can of worms that's happening worldwide, and an awareness that actually things need to change. And it's easy to be overwhelmed into not doing anything. And so this is partly why we wanted to begin today's service with a prayer. You know, Bible tells us pray on all occasions, and pray when you've got clumsy, inexperienced words in knowing how on earth you even talk about racism when you're in church. It's not something we do, and it's something that we have missed hugely. So as I was coming to pray about this stuff, I was like, Lord, I don't know how to start. And I just remember the beautiful template that Jesus gave us in his prayer. So I'm going to use that as a framework to pray and just encourage everybody to come and join in prayers. There'll be a little pause in between sections. So if there's your own things that I haven't articulated or you want to add, then please join in, and please forgive my clumsy words and my dusty words, Lord, that I don't use. So let's get ourselves into an attitude of prayer. Father, we invite you to come and lead us in prayer by the power of your Spirit. Thank you for the words that you've given us when we struggle to find the right words ourselves. And come and teach us to pray. Amen.
So we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
We're going to pause right there. And we're just going to take that very first phrase and use that to begin our prayer. So, Father, as we come together to pray, we acknowledge that you are our loving Heavenly Father to all people of every tribe, tongue, and nation. Whether we know you or not, you love all people across all the world. Today, we lift up our Black communities, friends, families, and neighbours here and across the world. We especially lift up those suffering as a direct result of the death of George Floyd. We ask that you would bring peace and healing to those communities in the US and across our broken world.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Jesus, you seek what's right and hate all evil. In your kingdom, your word says there will be no pain and no mourning. Come and fill our world now with truth and hope. Raise up righteous men and women to bring transformation to our broken society. And give us all courage to speak out against evil regimes that oppress the weak, poor, and vulnerable. To be a part of rooting out everything that is unjust in our own society. We ask, Lord, that you would bring peace and healing to our broken world.
Give us today our daily bread.
Lord, you are our provider. Every good and perfect gift comes from you. Lord, in the light of this week's protests, we acknowledge the unfair systems we have in our own nations that we have knowingly and unknowingly participated in. That our lack of action has caused all that is wrong to continue and bring more pain and suffering. Jesus, we also think of times where we have taken more than we need, only thought of ourselves and not shared the good things we already have. Jesus, we pray that you would give us what we need and teach us how to steward it well. Give us generous hearts, generous hands, and generous feet. Help us, Lord, to be grateful.
Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
Lord, we repent for the mess we have made and the hurt we have caused when we haven't treated our Black brothers and sisters as equals and have participated in systems that continue to oppress whole communities. We are sorry that we have turned a blind eye to the needs around us. And we have failed to speak out for what is right. We are sorry that we have allowed this to happen in our own churches. Please forgive us and wash us clean. Make us right in your eyes. Bring kingdom order to our broken world and healing in the church.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Spirit, as we go from here, teach us to remain in you, in Jesus. Teach us to hear your voice. We pray especially for those who now are in precarious situations, for those most vulnerable, most sick, and those with nothing. Keep us from feeling sorry for ourselves and help us to be seeking ways to be a blessing to others. Protect our hearts and minds from lies and distortions of who you are, and fill us with your hope and truth. Help us to live lives full of grace and not get distracted from our calling to love others as ourselves.
For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Everything belongs to you, and everything was made by you. Let us live, Lord, each day, remembering what you have done for us. Father, may we see every person the way that you do, and treat them the way that you show us to. May we love you with all of ourself, and love our neighbour.
Amen.
We all agree, Lord. We agree this together. We thank you, Lord, for all the saints, from times gone by, those living now, and across the world. We thank you, Lord, for saints who have stood up and fought for justice and righteousness. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of the church, the potential of who you have created her to be. May she become more like you every day and get ready for all that she has to do. Help us to play our part, Lord, in your precious name. Amen.
Amen. So we're going to continue in worship together, and let's move from this attitude of prayer to worshiping and praising our loving Heavenly Father together.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the sun sets free, always free. Child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Revelation 7:9 says, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands.
You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. Yes, I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free, always free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Father God, thank you that in you we find our identity, our peace. In you we find unity. Lord, come and work amongst us today. We pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Well, it's a real treat to be able to ship in a guest this morning. So it's not just us on the sofa. So we've got Wes, who is going to help us to look at God's word together. Morning, Wes. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Good morning.
Good. Say hello to the world.
Hello, world.
Excellent. Good. Wes, we love having you here. We love the videos that you're putting out for all the young people.
Thank you.
I'm gonna play the reading in a minute, which is a voice that people might recognise. But first of all, Wes, let me pray for you. And then after the reading, it's all yours, okay? Father God, thank you so much for Wes. And Lord, as he speaks this morning, may he know that he's loved. May he know your delight. And help us, all of us, wherever we are watching, listening from, to receive afresh your living word for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. As a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for human desires, but rather for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing and detestable idolatry. They are surprised that you do not join them in their reckless, wild living, and they heap abuse on you. But they will have to give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. And the gospel was preached even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to human standards in regard to the body, but live according to God in regard to the Spirit. The end of all things is near. Therefore be alert and of sober mind, so that you may pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power for ever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Wes, over to you. God bless you. Enjoy.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Wes. I'm a youth worker here at All Saints. And thank you for having me in your homes. I'm in the church centre today because my internet's pretty sketchy at home. So I've come down here and I'm in Mark's office. Have you ever had one of those Christmas round robin letters whose sole purpose is to tell you how amazing they are? So it'll go something along the lines of, the husband has just bought a yacht with his early retirement money. And then the wife has just earned £200,000 in the last month selling something or other. And then the son has just got into Oxford to do philosophy, politics and economics a year early. And then the daughter is going to be working for the London Philharmonic Orchestra and as a concertmaster. And you get them and you go, oh, I'm hoping that Peter's letter in 1 Peter was better received, because it was a sort of round robin itself, because it went round to all the churches in modern day Turkey. And its purpose wasn't to discourage. Its purpose was to encourage the Jewish Christians who were having a really hard time with their neighbours. However, in this section today, Peter is ramping it up. I think he's a bit like a football manager who's giving a half-time talk, and the people are sat in the changing room and they're feeling pretty despondent because the opposition's been tougher than what they were expecting. Heads have gone down a bit. There's been some lackluster running for the ball. Some people are thinking of calling it quits. And Peter is saying, come on, keep going. How you react now will show your commitment. Now, before we get going, I just want to go through four basics. And the first is that you and I can't earn our salvation, us being saved. It is a free gift, thanks to Jesus. And second of all, you and I will continue to make mistakes in this life. We will continue to do that. But number three, when we repent, not sorry, repent, when we turn away from that, we will be forgiven every single time. But number four, there is an edge to grace. The good news of Jesus is not without demands on our everyday life. Now, coming up to 21 years ago, I got married. And I said my wedding vows, and it was a ceremony, and I wear a ring, which shows my commitment to Lainey. Now, imagine if you'd been at the ceremony, and then you saw me a year later, only to discover that I undermine my wife at every opportunity. I'm seeing other women, and I clearly put myself first. Well, no matter how grand the ceremony was, how great the suit was, the food, the speeches, the ushers, etc., etc., they would count for nothing. You know how seriously someone takes their marriage by how they then live. And what Peter is saying in this passage is, you've made a commitment to follow Jesus. That's brilliant. But how serious are you about it? Are you wanting the grace and the love bits that airbrush out the other stuff? You see, the Bible is loud and clear that God cares about how you and I live our lives. He wants to deliver us from all the rubbish. He wants you and I to lead a pure life, and his spirit living within us can transform us if we're willing. And Peter is saying, be aware. Following Jesus will have consequences. Okay, the passage. Now, the NIV starts the word therefore. So we need to remind ourselves of what came in chapter 3, so it makes sense what Peter says today. And what Peter's talked about is he's talked about Jesus' suffering and obedience to God, the Father, and how this is an example to us. And in the same way that Jesus surrendered everything, are we prepared to surrender everything to God? Irrespective of our feelings about the situation, or whether we agree or not, will we surrender to what God says to us? Because you see, the more passionate you and I become about following Jesus, the more we will face suffering. Look what it cost Jesus. Controversial statement coming up, so you might want to close your ears. You know, I'd imagine you all start listening all the more now I've said that. If trouble is going to come my way following Jesus, I don't simply want fluffy Bible verses taken out of context on a fridge magnet. I don't even want to meet up with a bunch of Christians and have a moan fest. I don't even want, as good as these things, well, this thing is, the latest Hillsong or Bethel album. I want practicalities. And Peter is so, so practical. And he gives us six kind of life hacks to stand firm in the storm. And the first one is in verse 1. Expect suffering. You don't see that on a fridge magnet. It's going to come your way if you're following Jesus. And Peter is saying, don't be surprised. In fact, if you're not sometimes facing grief for being a Christian, perhaps you're not being as much salt and light as you could be. How do we expect suffering? Well, Peter says to arm ourselves, not with an assault rifle, but with the same attitude as Jesus. What was Jesus' attitude? Well, Peter then talks about that in verse 2. When you're suffering, pursue God's will, not your own one. Now, when I'm suffering for being a Christian, my default mode is to try and get out of the situation as quickly as possible, to back down, to keep my big mouth closed and try and get out, try and avoid the suffering. That wasn't how Jesus dealt with it. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus is soon to be crucified. He's facing unimaginable anguish and pain. And what does he pray to God? Not my will, but yours. In the previous chapter, Peter said, remember, it is better to suffer for doing good if that is what God wants. Number 3, in verses 3 and 4, mentally prepare yourself for abuse from others. No matter how loving and kind you and I can be, we're going to face abuse for being a Christian sometimes. Jesus was more loving and kind than us, and he ended up on a cross. I think Peter's like a football manager here. He's saying, come on, you've left that other stuff. Surely you've had enough of that stuff. Let's move on. Now, in Peter's day, every trade had an idol, and you would meet and worship the idol. And of course, Christians stopped going to these meetings. And they were accused when they did that of being disloyal, disloyal to their trade, their family, even the nation. Do you know, in North Korea, today, in 2020, following Jesus could very likely cost you your life. In the UK, we're probably going to get a few sarcastic comments, and sometimes we might be ostracised. But my question is, what if that ramps up one day, when the cost of following Jesus is greater than what we experience now? There's a well-known story, I don't know if it's true or not, but a well-known story of a group of Christians meeting during Soviet Russia days. And suddenly two soldiers burst in and they say, if people are prepared to renounce their faith, they can walk out the room now. And half do and half stay. And everyone understandably is terrified. And then the soldiers say that they are secret believers. And they apologize, I'm hoping, for terrifying everyone. But they say, if people aren't willing to die for their faith, they cannot be trusted. I find verses 5 and 6 really tough. Peter says, soberly remember that those who judge you for being a Christian will one day be judged themselves if they stay on the path they're on. I find that really tough. Peter is saying, think long term, not short term. He's certainly not saying, ha ha, we're going to win in the end. Surely this should spur us on, rather than feel anger when we face opposition, to actually have concern and love, that we have a mission to show that there is a different, better way, which is following Jesus. Verse 7 has the fifth life hack. It's the one I forget to do. Pray. I forget. Run to God. He is a refuge and a stronghold for us in times of trouble. And incidentally, Peter isn't wrong here. When he says Jesus is coming soon, another way of saying that is Jesus' return is imminent. Everything Jesus has done, everything Jesus needed to, has been done. He might come back tonight. He might come back in 1,000 years. I don't know. But in another way, it's imminent as well. Earlier in the week, I put my details in one of those terrible life expectancy websites. Oh, and it said to me that I got 39 years left to live. But in one sense, that's good. We're not on this earth long. It's short for us. We don't want to waste our lives. Finally, point 6. Peter says, when times are tough, instead of throwing pity parties, let's love each other, which will stop us grumbling about each other. Let's be ludicrously generous, not only with our stuff, but with the gifts God's given us. And rather than wishing that we had different gifts and comparing our gifts to everybody else, let's just accept that God is God and he knows what the right gifts are for us. And he's given them to us to give out to others. And in serving, we'll bring glory to God through Jesus, which is what it's all about. It's why we're here on planet Earth. In other words, when we are facing tough times, instead of going inwards, let's go outwards. 6 life hacks. Isn't that an upside down, crazy community we join when we become Christ followers? That in following Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who was also God, we will face suffering and abuse. That we should prepare ourselves for this, submit ourselves to God, and rather than throw a pity party, throw ourselves into loving God and our neighbour and the oppressed in this world with all our heart and soul and strength. You know, Peter wrote this probably 2 years before he was crucified upside down. What an example he sets for us, whilst pointing to Jesus's perfect sacrifice. I'm going to finish with a bit of personal thought. I think this lockdown has been a brilliant opportunity for us to review where we are spiritually. And when I say this, I'm saying this so to myself. Are we bumbling along, wanting to take the love and the grace bits, but avoiding the tougher stuff? You know, Jesus has got some really tough, hard-hitting stuff to say about lukewarm Christians. The Bible says God hates it. May I encourage you, and I am so speaking to myself now, to take this stuff more seriously than we ever have before, to recommit ourselves to putting Jesus first in our lives. We're not here for long. And Jesus is saying the harvest is ready here in Weston or wherever you're listening from. We're just missing some harvesters. So come on, let's go for this. Ephesians 4:1 says, lead a life worthy of your calling. For you have been called by God. Let me pray. Dear Jesus, I want to thank you for the amazing sacrificial life you led And we are sorry that sometimes we can be so half-hearted, especially when we face tough times. And we want to follow you come what may. We want to sling off everything that holds us back, and we want to fix our eyes on you, Jesus. Because we want to play our part in your kingdom, loving others and loving you. So help us to throw off jealousies and pick up love. And may we use the gifts we have been given to bless others, especially the oppressed, and to give all the glory to you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen, Wes. Thank you so much. That is so helpful. We are going to move straight into worship now, and Pam is going to lead us. So let's hand over to Pam.
Be still in the presence of the Lord. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here.
Thank you so much, Pam, for leading us in worship. And the way that Pam ended there with just praying over the city, declaring God's goodness, his movement, his kingdom come. Make that your prayer. Yeah, make that your constant prayer for the road that you live in, for the people that you bump into, for those folks that are thriving and those folks that are really struggling at this time. We're going to continue in prayer for a little bit, and Phil is going to come and help us. So I am going to bring Phil in, and one moment, Phil. Brilliant. Phil is here.
Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body.
Here's Phil. Phil, how are you today?
Hello. Yeah, I'm good. Thank you. Doing good. Well.
Thank you for coming and helping us to pray. Tell us what is going on with children and families, and then lead us into helping us to pray for it.
Okay. Well, so just a summary of what we're doing as church with children and families. On Sundays, there's quite a lot of stuff, if you haven't seen it, on the church website, which we're putting together each week, which involves some stories and some questions, the Bible reading, some craft. Here's a couple of beautiful things that Hannah Pearson and Emily have demonstrated and led us in. And these are some woven hearts. And it's all linked into the theme, because these are talking about how you can use your gifts to love the people around you, which kind of comes from the latter part of the Bible passage today. What else are we doing? Midweek, there are groups, Zoom groups happening, one for preschool and Key Stage 1 children, where we do some singing, have a Bible type story and a bit of prayer, and then games and kind of Bible related stuff later in the week for some older children. On Fridays, Toddler Rock, which is our brilliant toddler group, headed up by Pip Wynn, they are still meeting, but on Facebook. So every Friday they put together some content and people connect with that via Facebook. And then just doing various different things, stuff to engage and inspire children and families as they go. And so I've been doing some memory verses, little short video clips. There's the WhatsApp groups, which people are connecting through, and then odd small challenges. And there's a new challenge coming up, which is quite exciting, which is going to be a rock snake, which is going to be in the churchyard, where basically people can bring a rock and add it onto the snake. And so there's stuff for wider community engagement.
Do they have to do anything with the rock?
They have to decorate it. So there'll be some information going out and coming on the website very soon. But that is hot off the press. So it's not on the website yet.
Phil, we'd love you to help us to pray.
Okay. So we're going to pray for my area of work, which is families and children's. And I thought it'd be lovely if, guys, this morning, you can pray for three things. First one being parents. Second one being schools and nurseries and preschool settings, and the third one being children themselves, if that's okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold up a little amazingly beautifully crafted sign, and then I'm going to say a couple of things to prompt you in prayer, and then maybe have a bit of silence for you guys at home to pray into those things, if that's okay. So the first thing we're going to pray for is parents. So the things that I thought come to mind talking about parents at this time is, first of all, there seems to be a lot of anxiety. So parents finding things, worries about how to do this, how to live life as a family during lockdown, questions over how to do homeschooling, whether to send your children back to school, how to behave amongst friends as lockdown starts to loosen up. And also for parents, how to communicate all of what's going on at the moment with their children. All the stuff of this week, which Meg has prayed about earlier, all the stuff to do with coronavirus, all of that our children are picking up in little bits. So how, as a parent, do you bring your children through this time? And also, how do you find time for yourself within the household? And I particularly I'm thinking about also single parents who can't give themselves a break. So, Father God, I just want to bring all of our parents before you now. And all these thoughts about how to do life amidst lockdown and coronavirus as a parent. So let's just take a few moments to pray over those things at home. And Father, the next thing I want to pray for and for us to pray for is our schools and preschools and nursery settings. There's a beautiful stimulus for that. So, Father, I just want to raise our nurseries and our preschools as they, almost the unsung heroes in this, having to develop and change week on week with very little guidance. So, I think we could pray for peace, for clear leadership, for encouragement, and for protection over our schools as children start to dribble back in. And for those amongst our school and nursery and preschool leaders who know you, that they will seek you in this time and that they will share you in this time. So let's just take a moment to pray for our schools, preschools, and nurseries. And finally, we're going to pray for our children. And I think we pray for peace where there's fear, because I know some of what happens here is scary for children. We pray for joy to come in when there's anger and frustration. I know that my children have known frustration in this time, frustrated about not being able to meet up with their friends and family. Pray for wonder at the world around them. Lots of children are maybe experiencing their own surroundings, or maybe the natural surroundings around us. So blessed in this place. So just wonder at that. And finally, for hope for our children as they move on through this time. So, just going to raise our children to you, Lord, in this next 30 seconds-ish. And I've just got a little prayer that I'd like to pray to close this time. So I'm going to pray it and then you can amen it at the end. Ever-present God, be with us in our isolation. Be close to us in our distancing. Be healing in our sickness. Be joy in our sadness. Be light in our darkness. Be wisdom in our confusion. Be all that is familiar when all is unfamiliar. That when we open the doors and the doors reopen, we may, with the zeal of Pentecost, inhabit our communities and speak of your goodness to an emerging world. For Jesus' sake, amen.
Amen. Phil, thank you so much. I love the illustrations. Beautifully prepared. That's great. And we love what you're doing with your team and all of those different groups and the way that you're sustaining things with that team during this time.
I'd also just like to say thank you for those who are continually pouring out encouragement and sharing things that they've been doing at home as well. Yeah. It's really spurs me and others on in what we're doing. So thank you.
Brilliant. We're going to bring, see if we can bring Wes back. Ah, look, Wes has reappeared. Wes, morning again.
Good morning.
You're right.
5 minutes to morning.
Yeah. Wes is going to help us to pray for the young people and the young people's work. Wes, over to you.
Okay, thank you. So just really briefly to give you a little overview of the youth. And then I've got a very special illustration to show you, which will put Phil's to shame. But prior to that, obviously the lockdown has changed everything. So at the moment, I do 6 Zooms a week, 3 with Toast, and that's the younger group who are like 10 years old through to year 8, and then 3 with years 9 to 13. And we have guests, visitors, we have just fun stuff, and then some Bible stuff as well. And then on top of that, there's a daily YouTube, which if you check on the church website under the youth, you'll find that. And then just obviously just checking up on the guys and making sure they're okay during this really strange time. So to help us with our prayer, I got a very extensive sheet of paper, which I made when Phil was talking just now, because I was so shocked by how good his was. This is it. Prepare yourself. And I just think I can see Mark and Meg on my screen laughing as I show it, which is why I'm laughing.
I love it. I think it's amazing. And it clearly took you a long time.
It took a very long time, which is mind, body and spirit. And I just want to say really, really briefly, I'm just going to go through each one and then 30 seconds. If you could pray at home, I know the temptation is just to sit there, but please pray out loud. It would be great. For these, for our youth, because they are part of our church. They are so important to us. So the first one is mind. Could we pray for their mental health? I mean, the research is showing what lockdown is doing for all of us, but for teenagers especially. We're going to pray their protection at this time for mental health. And also that their education has been completely disrupted. Could you pray for peace with that? Especially those who would have been doing GCSEs and A-levels, going on to university, that God's got this. And if we could just pray for that situation for them, for peace. So that's the mind part. The body part is obviously their physical health, because the temptation is to sit and watch Netflix all day. So pray for physical health, etc. But also that they would support each other. I mean, one of the things we're trying to get across these Toast and Rendezvous groups is it's more than just friendship. You are there supporting each other on this incredible journey following Jesus, which is of such importance. So please pray that they will be a support to each other. And then finally, for spirit, if we could pray that during this time, when we face tough times, we can even move further from Jesus or we can go closer to him. And what we pray for them, we're praying for all of us, that we would turn to Jesus at this time and just rest on him and fix our eyes on him. So if we could pray for their mind, their body and their spirit, and then in 30 seconds, I'll wrap it up. That'd be great.
Dear God, we thank you. We thank you for the youth at our church and in this area. And we pray that you will protect their mind and their body and their spirit, that you have got such wonderful plans for them because you promise us a life in all its abundance. And I pray for these youth that you will protect them, that they will turn to you like never before. And that coming out of this, Lord, that they will be closer to you, Jesus, and on fire for seeing your kingdom come here. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Wes. That's great. Go and have a rest. All right. We worked you quite hard enough this morning. We are going to continue in prayer together just for a few more moments before we worship. So as we, bye Wes, God bless you. As we just spend a few more moments just sitting, resting in the presence of God before Joe leads us in a final song.
Yeah, it can be pretty overwhelming when we just on our own, ourselves, feel so utterly inadequate and unable. But we remember that the burden that Jesus has given us is light. We remember that we were not supposed to be doing this ever in our own strength. And actually our gift is the Holy Spirit. And as we are a week away from Pentecost, it's still Pentecost for us. And Lord, so expectantly, Lord, we come before you. Lord, there's so much to be done. But actually, Lord, we recognize right now that we can't do any of it without you. And we invite you in right now. Lord, would you come and fill our hearts, fill our minds, our bodies with your beautiful presence. Lord, that our thoughts will be your thoughts. Our love will be your love. And Lord, that our hope as a gift to the world would be your hope rising up in us. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and rest upon each of your children. Fill us afresh, Lord, we pray.
And as we just rest in this moment, you might want to become more aware of your breathing. As I spoke about last week, the word pictures with which we talk about who God is, his character, the way that we talk about his spirit, and one of those is breath. Jesus stood amongst them and breathed upon them. So as your breath enters your body, you can be saying yes to God, yes to his Holy Spirit. And as we receive more from him, we also hold before you those others who we know who at this time who are going through it. We pray your blessing on James and Virag and Sophie, especially at this time of year. We pray for Erica moving back home, Virag's mum. And we pray for those others, individual others, who I'm not going to name out loud now, but you know, who are going through it even right now, even this morning. And we pray, Holy Spirit, for your breath to fill them, that they might know your fullness. So let's move towards a time of worship together, and Joe's going to help to lead us.
How great the chasm that lay between us, How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Let's sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, praise the one. Set me free, hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Sing that again. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Sing hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free, hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are.
Thank you. Thank you, Father God, that you are with us in all circumstances, that you are our living hope. And Lord, there's no problem that is too big for you. Lord, help us to play our part. Help us to walk with you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
God bless, folks. Have a good week. Don't forget to check out the website for a whole load of details of things that we've mentioned this morning, including giving, including small groups, including the five habits of the way in terms of using this time to slow down and catch up with what God is doing. And of course, those resources on justice as well. God bless. Have a great week. We'll see you next week or before, because you are allowed now to gather in groups of six. And if you want to go and gather in the churchyard to pray, then do that. And one day we'll be able to meet again in larger groups. But until then, God bless. Take care.
The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. A thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you, and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you, and behind you, and
beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. For he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you. Amen. 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 Favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you. Ah.